Today, it's our hope that you will hear about our area's priorities and what they mean for our future growth. Now, we're not going to get into specifics. We're going to take examples from categories, but the idea is to let you know what we believe to be the important things facing our area from a legislative perspective. On your table, there are question cards. And so if you have a question that you would like to get answered, please fill out that question card and someone will come and pick it up. One of the ambassadors in the red coats will come and pick that up from time to time and bring it up for answering. Let's see, first we want to welcome Ms. Sharon Pitts, who is chairman of the Gulf Breeze Area Chamber of Commerce, who'd like to make a few remarks. Gulf Breeze Area Chamber of Commerce is one of our fellow sponsors. So Sharon, please come forward.
I'd like to start by thanking the members of our legislative delegation for participating in this collaborative effort to address some of the top priorities facing our communities today. My position on the Gulf Breeze Chamber Board of Directors has given me the unique opportunity to see firsthand the value of teamwork as our area chambers work in tandem to develop solutions to our local challenges. It's important that we focus on important issues such as workforce development and the long-term economic impact of construction projects like the New Bay Bridge. It is refreshing to be part of such a cohesive group that can truly address the needs of our community as a whole. Please join me as we welcome Pete King, past chairman of the Perdido Key Chamber of Commerce.
I'm very pleased to tell you that this afternoon, for the second time this year, the Visit Pensacola Board of Directors will be gathering to make some of those deliberations and to make this effective and efficient means of handling tourism for Escambia County a reality. I also wanted to say thank you to you for the support that you've given as a business community to Perdido Key. We are very pleased to announce that we have virtually doubled the tourism business at Perdido Key since the BP oil disaster. This is a tremendous achievement that I would say thank you to our staff and to our volunteers that have been on the key and throughout the Perdido Key area chamber to make this a reality. This has resulted in a tremendous growth in our membership. The business community has come to support us, and we say thank you. Another thanks, of course, belongs to our elected officials who have preserved and have encouraged this kind of business environment that helps us thrive in the tourism industry. But I also want to give a tip of the hat to Jerry Maygarten and to Scott Luth and to the group at Greater Chamber, because they are continuing this effort that goes well beyond just the tourism piece. This is something that is very dear and very close to the hearts of the folks in the West Pensacola, the Perdido Key area. Because we realize, for the same reason that we can draw people, the visitors, to our shores, we will be drawing populations as Jerry and Scott and their staff provide greater opportunities for businesses to grow in our community and for new jobs to come here. Those folks that are drawn to our sandy white beaches and to the shorelines of Inner Rarity Point and to Perdido Bay will want to live just as they want to visit with us. And so that will be a tremendous boon to the business economy that we are trying to develop along the Perdido Key and the Perdido Key area. For more good news about what's going on in the area, I'd like to bring Beverly Campbell up, who is with the Pensacola Beach Chamber. Thank you.
I'm so happy to be here today. I'm Beverly Campbell. I am chairman of the Pensacola Beach Chamber of Commerce. And on behalf of the Chamber Board and its members, we're so happy to welcome our guests here today. We think this is a great effort as far as pulling all the area chambers together. We believe working together we can show people that this is the best place to work, live, and play. So, of course, tourism is foremost on our minds out on the beach, but obviously the economic development of this area plays a big part in that as well. This is really high.
Meaning the microphone.
I'm going to try.
Yes. Thank you.
That's much better. We hope while you're here, you will have a chance to visit the beach and visit our restaurants and some of our entertainment facilities out there. We do think it's such a wonderful place, this whole area. We feel privileged we're working with the other chambers and we're able to show people that, yes, you know, we can really showcase what we have here. We've worked hard to organize events during our shoulder season to help bridge the gap between the fall and the spring. Really and truly September through February, we have come up with some events that we feel like are very important to help bridge that gap. We want us to be a year-round destination. We've worked hard to promote events such as Taste of the Beach. We had our celebrity chef this year, Andrew Zimmern, brought a huge crowd out to the beach. That was financed or funded with BP money. We plan to do the same type of event this year, and hopefully that will be something that we'll continue to do year after year. We appreciate all the support our area chambers gave us for that event. Our Art and Wine Festival is something we do in October. We showcase our area chefs. We had several chefs from downtown to come and visit us, and we showcase our area artists as well. So those are things during October that really help promote the beach. It was held on the boardwalk. We sold out our tickets, and we think it's going to grow more and more every year. Our Season Your Holidays with Island Spirit, that gets us right into December. We feature a lighted boat parade, a surfing Santa Beach parade, two fireworks shows on New Year's Eve, and then a polar bear plunge on New Year's Day. So these are just other things that we are doing as a chamber to help promote the area, and we plan to continue those. In March, we do a St. Patty's Pub Crawl. It's the largest in Pensacola, probably in the whole area, with 17 stops. We do a scavenger hunt for the kids, so it's a very friendly, family-friendly event as well. So the proceeds from that benefit Covenant Hospice. So we feel like we work with community to work. We work really hard to promote tourism, to help hopefully show people that we are the best. We'll continue to work very hard to make this beach and our area a year-round destination. We want to work with the other area chambers and the legislative bodies to help make this happen. We certainly appreciate all your support that you've given us throughout the BP oil spill, the disasters that happened with the hurricanes, all that. So we really all continue to need your support, and we know we have it. We know where we can go. We appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule to be here. And if there's anything at all I can do for you or our president, Nicole Stacy, please, please let us know. Thank you so much.
Here he said, I'm Justin Beck, the Vice Chair of Governmental Affairs for the Chamber. And before we get started, I would like to thank the Chamber staff for all of their hard work in putting this together. They do so much, y'all have no idea. It allows me and Gary and Jerry to get up here and talk. So if y'all give them a round of applause, that'd be great. I'd also like to thank our delegation for taking the time out of their schedules to be here today. Representative Ingram was telling me that there are something like 4,000 bills that have been introduced this year, and Clay reads every single one. So he has very limited time to be here. So. As we look at where we've come over the past several years and we look at where we're going, it's clear that Pensacola community is on the rise. Unemployment rates are dropping, construction is happening throughout the community, and our educational institutions are strengthening and adding programs. But we can and we should do more to make sure that these improvements are sustainable and as impactful as possible. To that end, the Pensacola Chamber supports several initiatives that are going to improve our economy, quality of life, and business climate. But this year, as Gary said, we're going to drill down a little bit deeper on a few examples and key points of how we can get where we want to be. Specifically, we're going to talk about creating more competitive business climate, workforce development, and infrastructure improvement. While there are several examples of how we can improve in these areas, today we have three members from our community that are going to speak about the work that they do every day and how the work that the delegation could do to help improve our community. So, to speak on business climate, we have Joe Bueller, who's the past president of NAOP of Northwest Florida, Commercial Real Estate Development Forum. Joe's a 30-year veteran of the real estate business and has worked with businesses throughout the state. We have Dan Bussey, who is the Workforce Education, the Dean of Workforce Education, excuse me, and Vocational Support at Pensacola State College. And then finally, you'll hear from Kim Adderholt, who is the Supervisor of Facility Planning and Project Management at that little campus that we have over there on West Nile Mile Road at Navy Federal Credit Union. So, without further ado, I welcome Joe Bueller to the podium.
As Justin said, I'm Joe Bueller. I've been in the commercial real estate business, unfortunately, for almost 40 years, Justin, not 30. And I'm president of my own real estate firm, J.G. Bueller & Company, since 1989. I've been asked to say a few words about the impact of sales tax imposed on commercial real estate leases. In my opinion, shared by many in my industry, this is an issue that continues to have quite an adverse effect on job growth in our area and throughout the state of Florida. That issue is sales tax applied to basic rent and common area maintenance charges, or CAM, in commercial leases. These CAM charges traditionally include real estate taxes, insurance, and property maintenance. Sales tax on commercial leases is currently 7.5% in Escambia County, 6% of which goes to the state of Florida. I believe charging sales tax on commercial leases in general is detrimental to job growth in our state. Essentially, we are adding to the overhead computation of those businesses that might consider expanding or relocating to our state. Certainly, it could be construed as double taxation when applied to real estate taxes included in common area maintenance charges. I've been challenged numerous times by my tenants, many of whom are national or regional companies, regarding the legality of charging a tax on a tax. Governor Scott recognizes the problem and has proposed $100 million in his current budget proposal to begin phasing out this unfair tax burden. I would hope our legislators undertake a serious review of this job-killing issue with the intent of eliminating sales tax on real estate taxes, and for that matter, reducing or eliminating sales tax on commercial leases. According to a study conducted by Fishkind and Associates on behalf of the Florida Realtors Association, a repeal of commercial lease tax would create over 184,000 new jobs annually in our state. The amount of revenue lost in eliminating sales tax on commercial leases would create five times as much in economic benefits for Florida. Incidentally, this is a cheap plug, Hank Fishkind is scheduled to be in Pensacola on May 14th to speak to our Commercial Development Association, known as NAOP, on this and associated topics concerning the future of economic development in the state of Florida. Those interested in attending this economic forum, which will also feature our own Rick Harper speaking to local economic issues, can contact either Justin or myself for details. In conclusion, I would urge our representatives to take action on this issue, which appears to have bipartisan support, to enhance our ability to compete and level the playing field with our sister states. We are told that we are the only state to charge sales tax on commercial leases. This tax is a job killer that is far overdue for the wastebasket of bad ideas. Thank you for your attention.
Although there are many aspects that a company takes into consideration when they're deciding whether or not to expand or relocate to the Pensacola area, one of the aspects that comes up on the top of the list is whether or not they can find the workforce to do the job. As a matter of fact, I keep being told that it's the most important factor that a company uses. Essentially, the question is, can we hire enough people with the right set of skills at the right time to meet our company's objectives? Ensuring that individuals have the necessary skills and training to be successful employees is one of Pensacola State's main goals. Not only are we working hard to ensure that students have state-of-the-art technical skills, we also understand that soft skills play an essential role in the ability for any individual to fit into an organization. I want to focus today on what we are currently doing, and then more importantly, spend the remainder of the time on the college's plan to meet the needs of aerospace education, as well as other high-tech, high-wage sectors. I want to assure you that the college is listening to our business partners. Each of our programs has an advisory committee. Those advisory committee help us make decisions concerning things like equipment, curriculum, as well as the industry certifications to attach to a particular program. The college welcomes this input to ensure that our graduates have the skills that companies need in the local economy. In response to local demand, we are in the process of standing up a Bachelor's of Applied Science in Cybersecurity. This degree is set to start in the fall and was designed with significant input from our cybersecurity business partners. The end result will provide individuals, our graduates, with the skills and industry certifications necessary for our business partners, your companies, ladies and gentlemen, to be successful. Under our manufacturing umbrella, Pensacola State is aligning our engineering technology AS degree to the recommendations of the Northwest Florida Manufacturing Council and the Florida Advanced Technological Education Center. This new alignment will have a specialization in advanced manufacturing. Additionally, this realignment will fully integrate the Certified Production Technician credential into our core courses. What this means is that any student entering our program with that Certified Production Technician credential will have 25% of our AS degree completed before they even walk in the door. This allows students to be in your doors in your employment offices that much faster. That's just a couple samples of the type of workforce initiatives the college has been working on. The real question today, however, is what's the college's plan to meet the needs of the aerospace industry? This plan consists of three separate phases. The first step was for us to look at the needs of the MROs, the maintenance, repair, and overhaul facilities. What they are telling us is they need individuals with the FAA A&P license, that's airframe and power plant. They also want individuals with years of experience in heavy aircraft repair. Unfortunately, the college can't do anything about the experience component, but we certainly can't stand up programs that will allow individuals to obtain that all-important A&P license. Phase one will have us begin two programs simultaneously. The first program is the airframe portion of that A&P license. The second program we would like to stand up is something that deals with aircraft coatings and corrosion control. These two programs would allow individuals with no experience to walk in the door of a maintenance and repair operation as an entry-level employee. Our initial estimates for the cost of these two programs, it's only a mere $500,000. How are we going to assist individuals who already have some experience in the aviation world? Our Center for Corporate and Professional Development would target veterans who have military aviation experience. We would design specific short-term courses that would allow individuals to take those military aviation experiences and transfer them directly to the civilian aviation market. Those short-term courses would allow us to make that transition from the military to the civilian world in a very cost-effective fashion. The phase two of our plan is to implement the power plant portion, again, of that all-important A&P license. Simultaneously, we would stand up a new avionics program. This program would complement our existing electronics technology program. The intent of that avionics is to allow individuals with no experience to obtain the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission's avionics license. Again, that license is a ticket into the repair and maintenance operations as an entry-level employee with no experience. The estimated cost for this portion, phase two, those two programs, an additional $500,000. Phase three has us standing up two additional associate degree programs, one specifically designed to train professional pilots, the second one allowing individuals to earn an AS degree in aerospace management. The final component of phase three would be to add a bachelor's degree in aerospace science. What this three-phase plan does is provide a complete career ladder to meet the immediate and long-term needs of the aviation industry. The plan also allows individuals already working in the field to obtain stackable degrees, allowing them to move into management positions in a quick and efficient manner. The plan additionally provides a continuous supply of individuals with aviation-related skills. This highly capable workforce would undoubtedly attract other aviation repair and maintenance companies. It would also attract suppliers and technical support companies that would need skilled workers for airplane assembly and sub-assembly operations. What we are really talking about, ladies and gentlemen, when you consider our IT cyber programs, our advanced manufacturing programs, and our plan for new aviation programs, is the foundation of a workforce that will fuel long-term economic growth for the greater Pensacola area. These programs and initiatives clearly fall under STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Fully embracing STEM programs in an integrated fashion would position Pensacola State to become the premier provider of workforce development, allowing existing and new industries to expand and flourish. So how do we integrate all of these programs, ladies and gentlemen, into one cohesive approach? The solution is relatively straightforward. That solution is to have the college erect a brand new STEM facility. The STEM facility would include the advanced manufacturing, the aviation programs, as well as our IT and cybersecurity. In addition to these high-wage areas, the new STEM center would also include math and science classrooms. The new facility would replace our existing Building 1. This new state-of-the-art STEM facility becomes a catalyst for expansion of current businesses, as well as a magnet for attracting new companies looking to relocate to the Pensacola area. What the college is asking for is $2.6 million for the planning of this new state-of-the-art facility. I've already asked you for your assistance in obtaining the necessary resources, the $500,000 to implement phase one of our plan, the airframe component of that AMP license, as well as the aircraft coating and corrosion control program. We also would need an additional $500,000 to implement phase two, allowing students to complete that all-important AMP license, making them even more valuable to the aviation industry. However, we clearly need everyone in this room to support Pensacola State's efforts for the much needed replacement of our Building 1 with our new STEM Education Center. This new STEM Center would allow Pensacola State to take workforce education to an entirely new level for years to come. Thank you for your support, and thank you for helping Pensacola State provide workforce education for our community. Thank you.
Well, I'm here to talk to you today about a very important infrastructure project for our region. It is the four-lane expansion of Nine Mile Road from what is currently a two-lane rural road, and we need it to turn into a four-lane highway. Navy Federal Credit Union is underway with a campus expansion project that will add a minimum of 1,500 jobs to our community. The economic impact of this project has been estimated to be over $256 million and create an additional 900 indirect jobs. Our phase one expansion does not currently exceed the level of service along Nine Mile Road. However, if we are fortunate enough to continue our business growth, which we expect we will, and additional phases are needed, the current infrastructure on Nine Mile Road will not support any additional growth beyond our planned phase one. Planning for these large developments begin years in advance, and we realized these limitations regarding the infrastructure in 2012. So we just started discussions with FDOT about Nine Mile Road at that time. The road expansion was in FDOT's long-range plan, however, it was not part of their five-year work plan. So we've worked with them over the past 12 months and have successfully worked together to move it into the five-year work plan and to elevate it to the top priority. In December of 2013, we received a commitment letter from Secretary Prasad that committed funding and a tentative schedule for the project, but of course those are contingent upon legislative approval. So I'm here today to ask for your support, to support this project when it's presented to you so that FDOT can fulfill their commitments to our region and remove that limitation for our future growth. The Chambers asked we share this story as just one example of how important infrastructure is to our community. not just for existing businesses, but also to entice new businesses to our area. And for those of you that may not be familiar exactly where Nine Mile Road is located, it is the main corridor that leads to Navy Federal, but is also the main corridor to the outlying Field 8, which I think most people are familiar with. There's lots of discussions about that too, becoming an economic commerce park. So this would benefit not us. This is a regional infrastructure project that would have great economic impact and allow us to continue to grow should our business growth continue. Thank you.
Joe's discussion about commercial rent was an example of something that would help to improve the business climate in the state. Our second legislative priority is workforce development, and Dan Bussey's remarks about Pensacola State College and its aeronautics and aerospace training facility, its STEM facility, are an example of that. And then third legislative priority is infrastructure, and Kim addressed that with the Nine Mile Road improvements. Again, this is not an exclusive list. These are simply examples. Now, it is my great pleasure to introduce my friend, Dr. Jerry Maygarden. It's a little hazy to me whether he earned his doctorate or whether it was awarded, but if nothing else, he gets a battlefield commission. So, Jerry, thank you very much.
Well, let me thank all of you for being here. One of the great joys in being invited to participate with the Greater Pensacola Chamber of Commerce over the last 6 months is the opportunity to be back in the business of community building. It's a joy. It's a gift. And I want to thank all the other chambers represented here today. We have a good collegial working relationship, but as we go forward, you're going to see more of an alliance as it comes to regional development all across this region, and I think it's going to be a successful cooperative relationship. And thank you all for being here and participating. I know that when I was in the legislature, one of the things that I always thought was sort of backwards was the fact that when I would come home, I'd be asked to speak. Once you come here and speak, once you come there and speak. When you're home, it's really a time to listen. And so when we planned this event today, what we really wanted to do was to outline some specific examples of areas of critical concern to this region. Workforce development, clearly one of those. Improving infrastructure is another. Getting our educational systems in place and up to speed where they need to be to serve the region is important. Healthcare is important. We happen to believe that workforce development begins somewhere around prenatal care. And it's important we begin working with young people early and often in order to get them up to speed. So we wanted to present you with some examples of what we think is important, but there are agendas represented all over this room that I know you're very aware of. The University of West Florida, Pensacola State College, the county, the city. There are a lot of legislative issues on the horizon, and what we would ask of you today is certainly keep your door open to those people. They have important issues, and they're going to want to talk to you about them. Now, along the Gulf Coast here, we have a thing called Lanyap. They tend to attribute it to that other place down the road here, New Orleans. But quite honestly, Lanyap is something we all share in common. It's something extra. And today, we have the privilege and special honor of having a very dear friend here in town who's conducting business on behalf of the Florida Chamber of Commerce. And I imposed upon him and asked him if he would come by and at least talk to you a little bit about the Florida Chamber's initiative, legislative initiatives, for this coming legislative session. Mark Wilson's a great friend. We go back a long time, and I want to ask him if he would come up and join us here at the podium. Mark, and you are welcome to address this body on behalf of the Florida Chamber of Commerce. Please welcome Mark Wilson.
Jerry is an amazing guy. The fact that you would organize this on a day that I happen to be in town was just so like you. I appreciate that. Thank you for giving me just really 3 minutes to share with you, I think, some great news about what's going on in Florida, and maybe a minute or so about some things I think as job creators and community builders, all of us would like to work on together. So, Jerry, first of all, thanks again for what you're doing. Thanks for your leadership in this community. Thanks also, Stan Connolly. Gulf Power is the regional chair for the Florida Chamber of Commerce. And in fact, Bentina Terry chairs our statewide foundation board. So this part of Florida is very represented on the Florida Chamber of Commerce board. I want to thank the legislators that are here. Also, especially thank our veterans. You know, I fight every day for free enterprise, but the truth is, you know, if it wasn't for what you did, we wouldn't have a free enterprise system to even continue to fight for. So thank you very much for that. I sure don't want to repeat anything that's been said, but big picture, let me put it to you this way. As the president of the state chamber, I'll tell you this. If I could buy stock in this company called Florida, I'd be buying as much of it as I possibly could. And just to put that in perspective, so 462,000 jobs the private sector's created in 3 years. North Carolina has created 300 net new jobs since 2000. Okay, go back home, Google that, and yes, I said 300 jobs since 2000. We've created 462,000 net jobs since 3 years ago. We'll do another 200,000 jobs this year. And I want to say a word about education. You just talked about workforce and the talent pipeline, and I don't think I don't think you could ever start that too early. So we do a lot of polling around the state, and most people think that Florida's education system's headed in the wrong direction. But the truth is, when you look at the facts and the outcomes, we've had 15 years of very focused reforms, all the way from pre-K to K-12, all the way through our workforce system. And the fact is, we've gone from bottom 10 in 1998 to top 10 in K-12. And this is our economic development weapon for the next 20 years in Florida. And if you want to look at some statistics that bear that out, look at fourth grade reading scores in our state. Number one in the nation, fourth grade reading scores. Number two in the world. If Florida was a country, not only would we be the 19th largest economy, but we would have the second highest fourth grade reading scores in the world, second only to Hong Kong. And most of you in this room are saying, I didn't know that. And then you'll say, and I'm not sure I believe that, right? So the rest of the country's paying attention. And if you're not into fourth grade reading scores, how about Hispanic high school graduation rates? Number one in the United States. If you're not into that, how about African American student achievement gains? Number one in the United States. This is what's happening in Florida's education system. And it happened because 15 years ago we had state leaders and business leaders who said, we have got to turn our talent pipeline into an economic development strategy. And so that's what's happening. So that's the great news that's going on in Florida. I said if it were stock, I'd buy it all. But there are a couple things I just want to mention, and then Jerry, I'll turn it back over to you. In no particular order, any good business leader, whether you're a small business or whether you have thousands, you've always got to be looking around the corner at, but what are the concerns? And the truth is, if you all are disciples of the book Good to Great like I am, you know we have to confront the brutal facts, not just talk about the things that are going great. And so we at the state level are looking at small business as the driver of what's going to take this state to where it goes next. 4 out of 5 new jobs in the next 10 years are going to come from small businesses. So there's a targeted tax incentive package this year that the legislature and the governor are looking at that we fully support. Yeah, we have $1 billion extra this year in the budget because jobs are happening again. And so we think small businesses deserve to get that back so that they can create more jobs. But the three concerns I just want to mention today, and we don't have all the time to get into them, pension reform at the state level is something that every family in Florida should be concerned about. Last year we had a $19.3 billion unfunded pension liability in our state, and even with the market doing what it did, it grew to $21.6 billion. So your legislature has to put $500 million extra every year into the unfunded pensions for the next 43 years. Why not move new employees to a defined contribution plan like the rest of us have, keep all the current federal or government employees in the current plan, but by switching that's $500 million a year that could go into infrastructure, projects like 90. It could go into a lot of other more important economic development drivers just by fixing that. Second issue, you know, every time I come to town, I'm talking about Florida's one big black eye we have is our lawsuit abuse system. And small businesses know what I'm talking about with frivolous lawsuits and settlement frenzies. 41st worst is the ranking we have in Florida, 41st worst legal climate statewide. Average family pays between $3,200 and $3,500 a year in higher, think of insurance, think of the cost of products, think of healthcare, because all this just gets passed on to the customer, onto the consumer. And we can do something about that. Our legislators can fix that. And all we need is our state senators to say, we're going to put small business and families ahead of the other groups. I'll end right there, but I want to say this. I would buy all the stock that I could, but what we need to do now as business leaders is we need to work with the local and regional leaders to make sure that collaboration happens. Because a concern I have, and all of you have this in your companies too, is when you launch a new initiative, like a jobs initiative that we've launched in Florida, but the state is moving faster than, say, a local government or a regional coordinating council. What happens is we eliminate 2,300 regulations at the state level, and we start investing in transportation corridors, and we're going 100 miles an hour toward job growth. But then all of a sudden you have a project or two that gets caught up in a permit delay, or they get caught up in we're not sure we want to do that here. And so Florida's big opportunity is to try to get everybody on the same page, and that same page is just is job creation. We have 6 million people moving to Florida between now and 2030. Huge growth opportunity for our state. And as business leaders, we need to stand side by side with our elected leaders to help them plan better over the next 6 million people than we did over the last 6 million people. And if we can do that, then Florida wins. So thanks very much, Jerry, for having me. Really appreciate the invitation. Thanks so much.
That's the Lanyap. You heard it from the man himself, and we really appreciate Mark taking time from a busy schedule to be here with us in Pensacola. I'm going to invite the delegation to come up. The House delegation is well represented here. Representative Mike Hill, Representative Broxson, Representative Matt Gates, Representative Clay Ingram. You have been filling out these cards, and I have a healthy list of questions, but I'm going to run a little risk here and actually turn the microphone over to these politicians for a few minutes. They've been very patient and they've been listening diligently, and the questions keep on coming. Some of you write like doctors too, I might add. But I did want to give them an opportunity to either respond to anything they've heard here today or talk about something that they see on the horizon in this session that's very important. I know they do see a lot of bills, beginning with committee meetings, which started in October, and I guess they downloaded a lot of bills this past December, and they're really busy into trying to figure out what all that stuff means and how it impacts their individual districts and communities. So they might want to address something different from what they heard here, but I do want to give them a couple of minutes each to say something to this crowd. And I'm going to begin. I don't normally begin on my left, but I'm going to begin with Representative Clay Ingram. Clay, if you would. And go right here.
Thank you all. And hey, I feel the same way about Pensacola and Northwest Florida as Mark feels about Florida in general. I mean, we're heading in the right direction. Leader May Gardner, doing a great job. All the surrounding chambers, I appreciate your support as well. We go up against these huge 40, 50, 60 member delegations. And the one thing that we have to support us is that we know that we have the support of the business community at home. That means a lot. I want to make sure I thank you for that. But to address quickly the points, Matt Gates made me cut down from Clay Ingram's 100-point plan to improve Florida down to just a few points. So I'll do that. Joe, you're not the only one. I mean, NAIOP obviously has pushed the issue, and I think it'll be successful. I've heard from large box retailers that want to move to Florida. If another state and Florida are essentially equal, that lease tax will kill the deal and they'll go to another state. And so I think that's something that will bring jobs here. It's hurting us now, and it'll be a big improvement. Pensacola State College, we hear you loud and clear. Workforce development is the issue. We're trying to bring businesses here. We've got to have the workforce. I know we're working with Dr. Meadows to get that building one built. if we only knew someone in the Senate that might see their father at Sunday dinner and push it on the Senate side, that'd be helpful too. So we'll do what we can in the House, and maybe the Senate will play as well. And the four-laning of 9 Mile Road, I know that's important. Infrastructure is important, and we'll make sure to push that. A couple of things that I've been working on that have been chamber priorities. One is a current chamber priority at the state level. The first one that's been a big thing in the past is the synthetic drug issue. You know, the scenario is if you're trying to bring your business here and you open the paper every morning and there are you know, terrible crimes being committed, you know, is that really where you want to move your family? And so we're attacking that again. The problem, if you'll remember several years ago, we started off with several hundred substances on this list of synthetic drugs. And these are the drugs that you read about in the paper where people strip their clothes off and run outside and do all sorts of, you know, crazy things and commit terrible crimes. So we're making a dent in that. Several hundred substances a few years ago, we're down to 4 now, which means we're making significant progress. I hope the law enforcement can see it on the street level. We've also included the drug Molly, you've probably heard about. It's talked about in songs on the radio and things like that. Another terrible drug. If we can get that off the streets, that will be a big deal for us. The other chamber priority that I'm working on, the Florida Chamber actually brought this issue to me. They said there were large businesses in Florida, and this affects small and medium businesses as well, that want to make someone's status as a veteran part of the qualification and the hiring process. And they felt like in Florida, they do this in other states, in Florida they can't do that without fear of an equal employment lawsuit. The Civil Rights Act specifically carves out the ability of a state to enact a reform like this, which would allow a company to make someone's status as a veteran, take that into account as part of the hiring process. And so I hope this will pass. It actually got rolled into the big GI, sort of the GI bill that we're doing at the state level. So I feel like that policy will pass, whether it's my bill or not. That'll be a big thing for veterans, in the state. So a few things I've been working on. We're, again, grateful to have your support. Good to see all of you. Thank you. And if you need anything from me, the door is definitely open. Thank you very much. Take care.
Let me call up Mike Hill, Representative Hill, who's the newest member of our delegation.
I am so honored to be serving with our Panhandle delegation. I'm learning from the seniority that is represented here, Matt Gase, Doug Broxson, Greg Evers, who isn't here today, and Clay Ingram. It is my honor to serve with them. And I just want to say, Joe, you raised such a very valid point. There is a bill that is actually addressing that. I can assure you I will vote yes on that bill. It is something that needs to be taken care of. I'm encouraged by what I hear about the workforce development efforts that are going on here. Again, another example of why things look so bright here in the Panhandle. There's also been a bill filed to expand 9 Mile Road. I've been speaking with Secretary Pradath about that, and hopefully that's going to go through also. I'll share with you just 2 bills that I'm working on that I hope will also pass this year. Looks like they will. One is to lower, return back to the 2009 rates, what it costs you to renew your driver's license and license plate. You'll recall it doubled in 2009. We're going to roll that back. The governor has made that part of his big tax package, so hopefully it's going to go through, and we're eager to see that get done. Another bill that I filed, I'm working with Commissioner Adam Putnam on, is right now only businesses pay what is called an energy consumption tax. It's 7%. Alabama and Louisiana don't have it at all, and we are the highest of any state in the Southeast area. So in order to make us more competitive, bring more businesses here in the area, Commissioner Putnam and I are working on cutting that in half, making it 3.5%. Then the other 3.5% are going to be dedicated to PICO dollars, so that our infrastructure for our school system from K through university is going to receive a steady stream of funding. And then also attached to that same bill is going to be a tax-free holiday on a purchase of energy-saving appliances. That's going to be a win for our environment, for consumers, for retailers, and manufacturers. So all these things are going on because, one, we do have a governor who is doing an awesome job, Governor Rick Scott, and we have a conservative legislature which is putting in place those principles of limited taxes, low government, limited taxes, personal freedom, and individual responsibility. Those principles work, and we're seeing it being done in Florida. Thank you so much. It is my honor to serve you.
I represent none of you. But I don't think you know that, because you are my friends, my advisors. When I run for office, you're my contributors. And most importantly, you help encourage us as we do the work of Northwest Florida over in Tallahassee. It's so gracious of you to include me today. Even more gracious was the fact that the kitchen staff allowed me back to mix up some of the brownies that you have before you. I was elected with Doug and Clay in 2010, and Florida was really on the rocks in 2010. State revenues were declining, enrollment in our schools was going down, people were leaving our state, and the question was a legitimate one, whether or not Florida's run was over. Now here we are in 2014, and this year, 1,000 people a day will move to the state of Florida. And they're moving here because of these priorities you've laid out. We are investing in infrastructure. We're trying to build a workforce that's competitive for the coming decades. We're ensuring that our business climate is secure, and that magnet is bringing those folks here. And listen, if 1,000 people a day move to Florida, there's not a whole lot those of us in government can do to screw it up. Because that's 1,000 people that are buying homes, engaging in commerce, starting businesses. It's more customers, it's more people contributing to this robust economy that we want to build. In 2010, Escambia County had a unique distinction that was not one to be proud of. In 2010, this county was the number one per capita murder county in all of Florida, more than Miami, more than Hillsborough, more than Palm Beach. The reason that that was occurring is that we had so much gang activity in Escambia County, it was inflating those crime statistics, and as Representative Ingram said, you about couldn't open the newspaper without seeing a horrific murder or other drug-related offenses. That's why I'm so proud that last year, Representative Ingram and I worked together and passed the Gang Prevention Act, which is now regarded as the strongest anti-gang legislation in America. And today, I mean, as we are here, our excellent state attorney, Bill Edens, when he is able to catch these folks and put them up for trial, he's able to introduce the evidence of their gang membership during the sentencing phase of trial, and that's leading to longer prison sentences, and it's deterring that crime in our community. And I can say now that Escambia County no longer is the number one per capita murder county in the state of Florida. So thank you, Representative Ingram, for leading that effort. This year, there are a couple of initiatives that are important to me, and they deal with the most vulnerable among us. I've learned that in the last decade, the state of Florida has released nearly 600 violent sexual predators out into the wild, each of which has reoffended. My counterpart in the Senate is Senator Greg Evers. He chairs the Criminal Justice Committee in the Senate. I chair the Criminal Justice Committee in the House. And so this year, Senator Evers and I have worked together to build the strongest anti-sexual predator laws in America. And from this point forward, if our laws pass, anyone who violently rapes a child under the age of 12, a senior citizen, or someone who's developmentally disabled will face a 50-year mandatory minimum state prison sanction, so that by the time they get out, they can't hurt anybody ever again. We're going to strengthen reporting requirements. We're going to empower law enforcement more. Right now in Florida, if someone is released, they can simply put homeless on their driver's license, and then there's no way for us to track where they are. And as my good friend Senator Evers said, well, Matt, if they're living under a bridge, I want to know whether they're living under the east side of that bridge or the west side of that bridge. And so we'll certainly have those tools at our disposal. Another issue affecting some of the most vulnerable among us. In Florida today, there are 125,000 children with intractable epilepsy. Some of them seize 200 or 300 times a day. Most of these children will never see their 20th birthday. Each night, they hope they make it through the night so that tomorrow they can have the worst seizure of their life again. In Colorado, we've seen miracles in the mountains where folks have bred down THC in marijuana, the element that gets folks high, and they've bred up the CBD that gives people the power in their neurons to be able to control seizures. Kids go from being on feeding tubes to being able to ride bikes and have friends and
tell their parents they love them for the first time. This is a politically bumpy issue, particularly over in my district. But the number one priority I have this year is to ensure that we are able to get non-euphoric medical marijuana into the hands of those kids so that they can live longer, more fulfilling, healthier, pain-free lives. And I hope you'll support me in that effort. I agree with everything Mark has said, Mike and Clay. The future of Northwest Florida is so bright. Thank you for letting me represent you.
And every time I hear Matt speak, I think about what his father told me, that one of the genes they have is when they were born, the first day, they not only spoke, but they spoke perfect English. Mark Wilson said if he was in Florida, he would buy stock in Florida. If I lived in Florida and I had a place that I wanted to buy the best stock, it would be the Panhandle. That's not rhetoric, that's a fact. We are the envy of every part of this state because we have plentiful water. The next great battle in this state is going to be about water. And we have the aquifers and the natural resources to service every industry, every new visitor, every new resident for the next 30 years. We have an area where you can plant cotton in the morning and jet ski in the afternoon. Now, can you imagine that? That's kind of a mind warp to imagine some of these farmers on a jet ski. But we are so fortunate to have a robust military that's expanding, that's sending a message to the world where Pensacola, where the Panhandle is. I'm honored this year to offer a bill that says to everyone in harm's way that's serving our country, that if you want to vote in Florida, you'll be allowed to vote on every initiative on that ballot. Florida now will be lined up with a few other states and the federal ballot to say to our veterans, if you'll fight, we'll let you vote on everything that we have in this state. That is important to us, and it's important to you. The thing that's going to separate us in the next 10, 20 years is how we deal with the money, the billions of dollars that we're going to receive from BP. It's going to determine our grandchildren and great-grandchildren's future. And if we do it right, Grover, and thank you for all your hard work, if we do it right, we're going to separate ourselves from the rest of the state, and our stock really will be worth more than any other region of Florida. It's an honor to serve you. It's an honor to be in Tallahassee, and it's an honor to be here today. Thank you.
I've got some cards here with questions on them, and what I'm going to do is read the question, and I'm going to give these guys an opportunity to volunteer to address it, and I have a little portable mic here, and we're going to let them respond quickly. No filibustering, or we'll have to go to the bubble and solve these problems. But we would like to have you at least respond to some of the questions that are on the minds of the people that are here today. And this one, now I assume if you put your name on here, you don't mind it being read aloud. If you do, you better get up and run. Given the importance of tourism to this region, as well as the state, what are your thoughts on increasing Visit Florida's funding in order to reach the goal of 100 million visitors? Guess who? Steve Hayes, Visit Pensacola. Would any of you like to respond to tourism and funding for tourism?
I would absolutely be in favor of increasing the dollars for tourism, to advertise tourism in the area. I would like to see, along with that increase, is a plan that's laid out which will show how those funds will be spent to make sure we have a great ROI.
This one was in the news media recently. New performance funding models are in place for institutions of higher education in the state. While accountability is certainly important because of the variables that exist between institutions, it is argued that current measures are not fair to our regional school, the University of West Florida. In essence, UWF could lose hundreds of thousands of dollars. How will our state delegates go to bat for UWF while maintaining this important funding initiative? Anyone, Doug?
We have, in this area, two of the most dynamic leaders in Judy Bentz and Dr. Meadows that we've ever had. They're both visionaries.
you have at Pensacola State College and the University of West Florida an open door policy. If you want a chance to get an education, we say, come to our doors. That's not true at Florida, Florida State, some of the other universities. They turn away hundreds and hundreds of people every year. That's not fair that we calibrate our funding based on that kind of formula. And hopefully, before it goes through the appropriations, we will deal with that issue with dealing with our smaller universities that have an open door policy and do not grade them at the same level that we grade the other universities.
Matt? I have a different view on that subject. Last time I asked Dr. Benz, the STEM enrollment at the University of West Florida was around 13%. That is poor. That is not good. Those are where the jobs are. And so we have to incentivize our institutions to get more people into the degree programs that matter to the workforce. We spent a good part of the day listening to why we have to get people in aerospace, in STEM. And if institutions don't evolve, if they become too tied to the interests of existing tenured faculty members and not the interests that matter to you, which is turning out people that actually can get jobs and don't end up 28 years old with a bartending job back home playing Grand Theft Auto, then look, there may be some growing pains, but I think they're necessary.
I do have to throw in 2 cents. I do have a long memory. UWF was one of the latter universities to occur. It was, for a long time, was among the smallest three. And in this state, quite honestly, when it came to the legislative process, years ago, not now, of course, the rich got rich and the poor got poor. So when it came time to delegate or parcel out programs, engineering went to Florida State, professional degrees went to Florida, and we had an opportunity to offer English and history here in the Panhandle. Quite honestly, funding for STEM's programming was a long time in coming to the University of West Florida, and we're also hopeful that we can play catch up and fund our university and our colleges. They need to be funded going forward. What are your thoughts on the collection of sales tax on internet sales to make it more fair on brick and mortar retailers? That's a loaded one. Anyone want to respond?
We already have a tax on the internet. It's voluntary. And frankly, the only ones who pay it are those people that work with the Florida Department of Revenue. But we are putting a great disadvantage to our people that pay the taxes here, that put our people through school. If we don't deal with that issue in the next 10 years, we're gonna have people go out of business, our schools are gonna deteriorate, and they're gonna have some beautiful schools in New York and Atlanta.
Seldom do I ever disagree with my good friend Doug Broxton, but I do on this one. I haven't seen a tax yet that I like. And to put a tax on something now on that is innovative, that is always expanding, evolving, and growing ever better, I don't see a benefit in that. Now, I understand the argument of, well, our brick and mortar here, people come and have to pay taxes. And so people can come, look at what they want, and then go buy it on the internet and not pay tax and get it less. Very seldom does that happen. We are an instant gratification society. When you go in and see a suit you want to buy, you'll buy it right there. Now, what the advantage of our brick and mortars have is that people can go in and touch and feel, receive the service that you cannot receive over the internet. So I am not in favor of taxing anything anymore. We are way too taxed as it is now.
You are, if you were, just the scenario is if you go buy furniture in North Carolina, on the internet or mail order or anything that's not the traditional going into a store and buying something, right now you are obligated to pay that tax. And the problem is, and we see this from constituents often, that they'll go buy furniture in North Carolina, usually on a trip, come to back home, the furniture is shipped in, and they're obligated to pay that tax. They don't know it, but a bill of lading comes through the Department of Revenue, and they're hit with this big tax bill they didn't know that they had to pay. The internet scenario is the same thing. That you buy something online, you're obligated, or I'm obligated, to pay that tax right now, sales tax, but the onus is on me to go to the Department of Revenue website, download a form, calculate the taxes, and mail it in. So that rarely happens. So as it's not a new tax, and as I said, I'm sort of trying to understand the issue myself, but we have constituents that call in often that somehow the Department of Revenue realizes that they bought something online, they're obligated to pay that tax, they didn't know it. So So I guess that the issue is, do we clarify that and change the mechanism of collection? So again, I'm definitely not in favor of creating a new tax by any means, but I just want you to understand what the issue is. It's not a new internet tax, but the issue is changing the mechanism of collecting that tax. Of course, if you're not paying it now, who wants to pay a new tax? So that there is the feeling of paying a new tax. So anyway, it's an evolving issue. I just want you to fully understand that you're obligated right now to pay that tax. Just very few people do that. So anyway, just for a point of clarification. Thank you.
This one has to do with beach nourishment. What is being done to target funding and make it available for beach nourishment in our local communities?
If you look at Pensacola Beach, it's different than it was 50 years ago. And yes, I remember 50 years ago. It is a problem across the state. Every time we have a hurricane, or in last year's case, Tropical Storm Sandy, it washes away areas that we built and we depend on for tourism. My hope would be, and I spoke to someone earlier, is that we create a mechanism in this part of the state where we take one of the five pots, or portions of the five pots that will come down from the BP money, and create our own ability to own our own equipment to do beach renourishment all along the seven counties along the coast. If we depend on Tallahassee, and I think someone else said it earlier, I mean, we're outvoted on every issue that has to do with funding, where if we're dealing with Pinellas or Duval or Miami-Dade, we're gonna lose. So we've got to learn how to solve that problem ourselves, and then any help we get from the state would be a bonus.
One question here on health care. What can we as the business community do to help promote wellness and curb health problems in Northwest Florida? Examples of which are childhood obesity, diabetes, STDs, heart problems, and so on. Health care issue.
The things the state has done, Senator Gates, Senate President Gates and Speaker Weatherford came through, I guess it was in the summer, close to a year ago, prior to this session, expanded on a few things that have been done at the state level and I think that we can embrace as a community here. Some of which are the expansion of the traditional, we have the community health centers here, expanding those. So we're in this boat now where we have the Affordable Health Care Act, and we're at a gridlock at the state level as to how we're going to deal with it. And so that's going to play out, however it plays out. The opening of health care centers is a big thing. Looking at alternative ways, access to care for the poor and indigent, whether it's them seeing a nurse practitioner or a physician's assistant rather than an actual doctor. There are some things we can do and embrace locally that are sort of outside of that debate that's going to go on with the Affordable Health Care Act. And so I think if we can embrace those things, and to look at alternatives, that puts us on a path to expanding access to care for those that can't get it now.
I'm glad Clay Ingram took the obesity question. I actually came here to lunch today partly just to catch his tapeworm. It used to be illegal in Florida for a health insurance company to give you an incentive to live a healthier life. I couldn't believe that. Clay Ingram and I actually together sponsored an amendment on the floor of the House to say if your health insurance company wants to offer you an incentive to lose weight, stop smoking, get on a diabetes treatment program, exercise more, that they can do that and give you an incentive. So here's my advice to you as business people. If you've got employees or people that you work with who are on their own doing what they can to live healthier lives, I would encourage you to contact the folks that you do business with to provide your health insurance services and ask them if they're utilizing the state law that allows them to be able to give incentives for that change in conduct. Because as we all know, the cost of these unhealthy choices is a cost that we all bear. And so I think the more we can create that individual responsibility and that personal incentive, the healthier we will be.
The state legislature, with the lack of PICO funds, how will we fund new buildings, renovations, and improvements in the future?
That was a question that I answered earlier in my opening remarks, and it has to do with the bill that I'm working on with Commissioner Adam Putnam to cut the consumption sales tax, the energy consumption sales tax, in half, and the other 3.5% is going to be used to dedicate the PICO dollars.
Now, financial analysis has shown that that's going to generate about $225 million a year. We know that's a drop in the bucket, but what is also available then is if the legislature decides to act on it, they can bond that money and instantly be provided with about $2.5 billion to help our infrastructure of our school system.
And then the other side of the coin is right now we have to put general revenue toward whatever building or repairs take place, and there'll have to be a commitment, and we will have repairs that need to be made and new construction will have to be done. And so general revenue is the source right now to plug that. So I guess we'll need to continue to push and work and make sure that the funds are put in place and that we get the share that we need to pay.
I want to thank the four area chambers of commerce who have participated in the sponsorship of this event. The Gulf Breeze Chamber of Commerce, Perdido Key Chamber of Commerce, Pensacola Beach Chamber of Commerce, and Greater Pensacola Chamber. Last and certainly not least, I want to thank our presenting sponsors, Penn Air Federal Credit Union, Gulf Power Company, Early Learning Coalition, Baskerville Donovan, Beck Properties, and the City of Pensacola. Please join me in giving those folks a hand. Thanks to each of you for being here today. Without your participation, this event could not have been the success that it is. Thank you very much. Have a great afternoon.